So good afternoon to all. For last lecture, what we have seen is design of key. Also, we have seen one problem related to the design of key. Now we are going to about to see the coupling, and we have also seen what are the expected or requirements of the coupling, and we were about to see this rigid coupling and or types of coupling, and we have seen this MOP coupling too. Please give me confirmation that can you read the slide? Yes, okay. So in this case, in MOP coupling, we have seen that what is the standard process which we can apply for the design of this coupling, and how the dimensions can be selected for this coupling. So also we have seen what are the dimensions, that is nothing but the outer diameter of this MOP coupling, how we can decide when you are knowing the inner diameter of that MOP coupling or outer diameter of the shaft. Okay. And also we have standardized its length of that MOP. Now here we are going to check it for the stresses which will get induced inside the MOP coupling. Now, for the designing of this MOP coupling, already we know that we are going to use the same procedure as we have used for the designing of shaft. Only thing is that for this MOP coupling, we are going to consider it as a hollow shaft, and it has to be transmit same amount of torque which has been transmitted or which that shaft has possessing. So first of all, what we are going to do is that we are going to design the sleeve, and later on we can design the key for that. Now for the sleeve, what we are going to consider, we are going to consider it as a hollow shaft. And for this hollow shaft, how much torque we have to transmit, that we are going to see. So suppose T is the torque which is transmitted by means of this MOP, and tau suffix C, that is nothing but the permissible shear stress in the MOP coupling. Okay, just a minute. Okay, and this tau suffix C is the shear stress which will get induced in the sleeve or that MOP. Okay, the safe value of shear stress for cast iron, suppose we are going to manufacture it from the cast iron, we can consider it as a 14 megapascal. Okay, and we know that the torque which is transmitted by means of hollow shaft, because in that case we are going to consider this MOP as a hollow shaft, and through that hollow shaft the torque which is transmitted when we are going to consider maximum shear stress theory, that is equal to torque is equal to pi by 16 allowable shear stress multiplied by capital D raised to 4 minus small d raised to 4, where capital D is the outer diameter of that sleeve and small d is the inner diameter of that sleeve or outer diameter of shaft, divided by D. So when we are going to write value of K, that is nothing but we can take this capital D common, and we'll write this small d divided by capital D as a K. Okay. So we can write this equation as T is equal to pi by 16 shear stress, allowable shear stress multiplied by the outer diameter of that sleeve into bracket 1 minus k raised to 4, where k is what? Small d divided by capital D. Okay. Now this can give us value of permissible shear stress for given diameter, inner and outer diameter of sleeve, and for given torque transmission, or for the torque which you want to transmit by means of any material which you are going to use for the sleeve. If you are knowing allowable shear stress for that, and if you are knowing the factor of safety, you can calculate inner and outer diameter of that sleeve. Now, when we are going to design key, the key for the coupling, that is nothing but we have seen in the first slide that the sunk key is used for that, or sorry, jib headed key is used for this. So this key, you can use plain key also, square or that rectangular key also can be used. So for designing of this key, same procedure we are going to use as we have used in case of design of keys. That is nothing but L, you are going to calculate as a capital L divided by 2. That is the standardization which we are going to do. So here, the key for the coupling may be designed in the similar way as we have discussed in the previous part. Okay. The width and thickness of the coupling key is obtained from the proportionate values, or you can follow the procedure which we have seen in the previous lecture for designing by considering the shear of that key as well as by considering the crushing stress inside that key. The length of coupling key is we have to take at least equal to the length of sleeve. Okay, so we don't have any question that how much length we have to select for the key. At least you have to select it equal to the length of coupling. That is nothing but this length of coupling or length of this sleeve. Up to that, we have to consider the length of key. Okay, so sometimes it is decided as a 3.5 times of D, as we are going to use this ratio or standard dimensions. Okay, the coupling key is usually made up of two parts, so that the length of key in each shaft will be equal to, or say it will be same. So half of the length which is inside the driving shaft and half of the length will be to the driven side or driven shaft. Okay. And if you are going to take it equal to the length of that muff, then the length which is inside the shaft, that will be, we are going to consider small L is equal to capital L divided by 2. That is nothing but length of that muff or length of sleeve divided by 2. Length of sleeve, we are going to consider it as a 3.5 times of the diameter of that shaft. So this equation will become 3.5 into D divided by 2. Okay. Any question? If you have any question, you are free to ask. If not, we are going to use the next slide and we are going to see it. After fixing the length of key in each shaft, the induced shearing and crushing stress can be checked. Okay. As we have seen in the previous lecture, that crushing stress or crushing stresses are calculated by means of considering the that compressive stresses in the key, and shear stresses are calculated by means of considering the shear of that key. Shear of that key here, which we have seen. This formula we have seen in the previous lecture while we have designed the keys. Okay, in that case, T is equal to L, that is length of key, into width of key, that is D, multiplied by allowable shear stress, multiplied by D by 2. D is nothing but the diameter of shaft. Whereas if you are going to consider the crushing stresses, only shear stresses, and its width will be get replaced by means of thickness. So L multiplied by T by 2 into allowable crushing stresses, that is compressive stresses, multiplied by capital D by 2, small d by 2. where D is the diameter of that shaft, T is the thickness of shaft, and L, sorry, T is the thickness of key, and L is the length of that key, which is inside the shaft, input shaft side or towards the output shaft side. This L we have calculated as capital L by 2. Got it? This is very simple procedure by means of which we can design this MUP type of coupling. Got it? Any question? If you don't have any question, we'll see one problem statement related to the MUP coupling design. Here, design a MUP coupling which is used to connect two shafts or two steel shafts transmitting 40 kilowatt at 350 rpm. Okay, two shafts are connected with each other and it is expected to transmit 40 kilowatt power at a 350 rpm. The material for the shaft and key is plain carbon steel, for which allowable shear stress and crushing stress may be taken as 40 megapascal and 80 megapascal. 40 megapascal is for the shear and 80 megapascal is for the crushing or compressive type of stresses, respectively. The material for the MUP is cast iron. Normally, MUPs are manufactured from the cast iron, for which the allowable shear stress may be considered as 15 megapascal. That is 15 Newton per millimeter square. Okay. Now, while we are going to solve this example, we'll take the given data, the problem statement. So, power which you want to transmit is 40 kilowatt, that is 40 into 10 raised to 3 watt. And speed of the shaft, that is N, is 350 rpm. Allowable shear stress in a MUP is 40 megapascal, that is 40 Newton per millimeter square. Allowable compressive type of stresses in the MUP is 80 megapascal, that is 80 Newton per millimeter square. Then allowable shear stress, it is for the shaft and key. Allowable shear stress for the coupling is 15 megapascal, that is 15 Newton per millimeter square. Okay. And here it is not mentioned any factor of safety. That's why we have to consider by our own that factor of safety. Or I will just reread this statement. The material of shaft and key plain carbon steel, for which allowable shear stress is given and factor of safety is not given. So first of all, we'll calculate the torque which can be transmitted by means of T is equal to P into 60 divided by 2 pi n. This equation has been derived from equation of power. Power is equal to 2 pi n t upon 60. From that, you want to calculate torque which you want to transmit. Okay. So 60 P power which is transmitted is 14 into 10 raised to 3 watt multiplied by 60 divided by 2 pi into n. N is 350. Hence, we are going to get it as 1100 Newton meter, that much torque we have to transmit. Now this torque which we have calculated is calculated in Newton meter. Okay, as we are going to consider this power in watt, that's why this torque value which we are going to get is we are getting in Newton meter, and it can be converted into Newton millimeter so that we can take dimensions of diameter of shaft as well as length of that MUP as well as outer diameter of that MUP in millimeter. Otherwise, we will get that all dimensions in meter. So, for sake of simplicity, what we are going to do is that we are going to convert this Newton meter into Newton millimeter. So, it is 1100 into 10 raised to 3 Newton millimeter, that much torque we have to transmit by means of MUP coupling. Any question? Let me know if you are having any question. You can write in chat box, otherwise we'll go to the next slide. We'll go to the next slide. Okay, when we are going to transmit the torque which we have calculated as 1100 into 10 raised to 3 Newton meter, that much torque has to be sustained by means of shaft first, and then afterwards by means of that coupling, as well as that torque has to be sustained by means of key also. So first we'll consider that dimensions which you want to calculate for the shaft. So torque is equal to pi by 16 into allowable shear stress in shaft material, or for the shaft material, multiplied by d cube. This is the formula by means of which we can calculate dimension of shaft, that is diameter of that shaft. So 1100 into 10 raised to 3 newton millimeter torque has to be transmitted by allowing shear stress equal to 40 newton per millimeter square for the shaft material. Okay, hence we can calculate that diameter of shaft is we can write this equation in terms of d. Okay, so when we are going to take the cube root of this d, we are going to get value of d as a 52 millimeter. We are going to approximate it to the 55 millimeter. Okay, this is the diameter of shaft. Now this diameter of shaft is going to become inner diameter for the sleeve. Am I right? Because sleeve is fitted on the shaft, so it is going to become small d, that is the inner diameter of sleeve. Now when we are going to design second part, design sleeve, capital D value we can take from the standard value, that is capital D, that is outer diameter of sleeve, is equal to 2 times of inner diameter plus 13 millimeter. Okay, so we have got inner diameter of sleeve as a 55 millimeter. So 55 multiplied by 2 plus 13, and it is coming as a 123 millimeter, which again we are going to approximate to the 125 millimeter, more than the actual value which we have calculated. And length of that coupling is 3.5 times of inner diameter. So 3.5 multiplied by 55, it is coming as a 192.5 millimeter. We can approximate it to the next standard value as a 195 millimeter. Now here, while you are solving problem, one can approximate it to the 194 millimeter. Okay, no problem. You can approximate it to the 194 millimeter, but not less than the value which we have calculated. Okay, if suppose we are going to approximate it to the 192, but actual value or calculations has given us 192.5 millimeter, so we cannot go for lower value. We can increase it, we can go for the upper one. You can approximate it to the 193 millimeter, 194 millimeter, 195 millimeter. Okay, even you can move 17% growth can be allowed. Okay, but in case of standardization, where the standard values we have to use, that is nothing but we have seen in case of selection of belt, in that case that all standard values for the pulleys are available, so we have taken the next value which is coming in that table. But here, as we are going to design it, we can go for the next standard value. Even you can go up to the 200 millimeter also. That can be considered as a correct answer while you are solving this problem in exam. But don't go beyond near about 15 to 20%. Okay, in such cases where you are going to calculate it, no doubt when you are going to select it from the standard table, at that time next standard value you can select. Getting me? Hope that everybody is understanding. Any question? I'll repeat this thing once again. Ki apan ya case madhe hi je value kadle 192.5 millimeter, hej next राउंड अप करण्यासाठी आपण 193 करू शकतो, 194 करू शकतो, 195 या केसमध्ये केले, पण ह्या 192.5 पेक्षा कमी करून चालत नाही. ओके, अदरवाइज आवर डिझाईन विल बिकम अनसेफ. ही पहिली गोष्ट. दुसरी गोष्ट, ज्या वेळेला आपल्याला सिलेक्शन करायचं आहे, आता आपल्या कॅल्क्युलेशन 192.5 मिलीमीटर आउटर डायमीटर आला, सॉरी लेंथ ऑफ स्लीव्ह आली, पण स्टँडर्ड जर आपल्याला मॅन्युफॅक्चरनी प्रोव्हाइड केलं किंवा डिझाईन डाटा बुकमधनं आपल्याला स्टँडर्ड लेंथ ऑफ स्लीव्स दिलेले असतील आणि त्या टेबलमधनं सिलेक्ट करायचं आहे, तर 192.5 च्या वरची जी कुठली स्टँडर्ड व्हॅल्यू दिली असेल ती आपण घेतो. like in case of belt selection of belt the belt selection madhe apan he baghitle pan hita ata tasa kai nahiye ita table kiwa kai ase nahiye ki jyachatun aplyala hi value select karayche hi apan approximation karu shakto next round of value sathi ती करताना जास्तीत जास्त 15 ते 20% ने जास्त करा त्याच्यापेक्षा जास्त करू नका ओके केली तर नो प्रॉब्लेम इन ऍक्च्युअल प्रॅक्टिस गेटिंग यू आर इन्क्रीजिंग मटेरियल कॉस्ट इन दॅट केस अँड इफ इट इज सुटेबल फॉर युअर प्रॉडक्ट यू कॅन सिलेक्ट इट ओके ॲज अ डिझायनर बट वेन यू आर सॉल्विंग इट इन एक्झामिनेशन ॲट दॅट टाइम डोंट गो बियॉन्ड 15 to 20%. गॉट इट? Have you got it? Yes, okay, no problem. So next, what we are going to do is that once you are going to decide inner diameter 55 millimeter, outer diameter 125 millimeter, length 195 millimeter. So MUB has been designed, or values of that MUB has been calculated, dimensions has calculated. But here we are not going to restrict our job. We are going to check it whether that designed MUB is capable to transmit that torque which you want to transmit. Here you want to transmit torque equal to 1100 into 10 raised to 3 Newton millimeter. So for shear stress, whether that shear stress is within the allowable limit or not, that you have to check. So we will check it for the allowable shear stress. So torque which is transmitted by means of hollow shaft is given by same equation which you have used for the solid shaft is applicable for the sleeve or hollow shaft. Okay, only thing is that d, that is the diameter of shaft, is replaced by my means of inner diameter and outer diameter of that sleeve. Okay, so t is equal to pi by 16 allowable shear stress into capital D, that is outer diameter of sleeve raised to 4 minus inner diameter of sleeve raised to 4 divided by T. Or if you are going to take ratio as a small d divided by capital D as a K, this equation will become pi by 16 allowable shear stress multiplied by outer diameter of that sleeve cube into 1 minus K raised to 4. Okay, now for this sleeve, allowable shear stress is 15 Newton per millimeter square. So we have to just check it whether it is below the 15 Newton per millimeter square. Okay. So here you can put value of outer diameter as 125 millimeter, inner diameter as 55 millimeter. Okay. And torque which you want to transmit is 1100 into 10 raised to 3. Once you put these values, you will get that value. Okay, here I have not solved it. Can we take 1 minute to solve it? Will you please solve and give me answer? Yes. How much value, that tau c value you are getting? Whether anybody has calculated it? Okay, I will calculate it. I will tell you. Yes, who has calculated it? First of all, we have to calculate d, small d divided by capital D value, that is K value. It is 55 divided by 125, which is equal to 0.44. This 0.44 is multiplied with cube of 125 we are getting that value divided by 16 multiplied by pi and this whole value will get divided to the 1100 into 10 raised to 3 and this value is coming equal to the 6.51, which is well below than the 15 newton per millimeter square. So here the value which we are going to get is equal to the 6.51. Okay, that is allowable shear stress in this case for the coupling, and which is below than 15 newton meter. Likewise, you can calculate it for the allowable crushing stresses. So crushing stresses are replaced here by means of shear stress, and you can calculate it whether it is within the allowable limit or not. What it? Any question related to this example? Let me know. Otherwise, we will move to the next slide. Yes. Do you have any question related to the example which we have solved right now? Let me know. Are you able to listen to me? Yes, add time calculation which value given means what? Only standard. Will you please unmute yourself? I'm not getting your question. At the time of calculation, which value is given? Will you please unmute? Shubham? Hello? I'm not able to listen you, Shubham. Will you please unmute yourself?
Capital D chalo sir 130 ya 125.
No, I'm not able to listen you. Shubham, what do you want to say? We take 123 or 1. Okay, we are going to take it as a 125. If you are going to select it as a 125 approximation, then we are going to take 125 only. If you are going to take 123, suppose you are solving that problem and you are approximated it to the 123, then for your calculation, you have to take it as a 123. If I am going to solve that problem and if I approximate it to the 125, I have to select or I have to take that 125 for the calculation, not the actual one which you have calculated. Got it? Yeah, okay. Any other question? If not, we'll go to the next slide. In this case, now we are going to see flange coupling. okay, all these are coming under the rigid coupling category. First we have seen very simple MUB coupling, okay, and MUB coupling design procedure is very simple, which already we have seen, like it is considered as a hollow shaft through which power is transmitted. Now first of all, here when you are going to see the flange coupling, this flange coupling is usually applies to coupling having two stepped cast iron flanges, okay, that is nothing but the step which has been provided here is hub and flange, okay, and this projected flange is used to couple together by means of fastener, okay. Each flange is mounted on the shaft and keyed into it. That is nothing but separate key is used for the input shaft to mount the flange, and separate key is used for the output shaft to mount the flange. Okay, so like in case of MUB coupling, single key was used, but here for the two different flanges, two different keys are used. Okay, the faces are turned up to right angle to the axis of the shaft. That is nothing but this flanges faces are machined and they are made right angle to the shaft. Okay, one of the flange has a projected projections and other flange has a corresponding traces. Here you can see, I will show you that this is a part which is projected from the left hand side coupling, and this is the traces which has been provided to the right hand side coupling, which will get match with each other. Okay, normally this male and female flanges are used to couple two shafts together, but some flat flanges are also available which can be used. Always while you are purchasing these flanges, they are purchased in the couple, but if it is not possible, then if you want to replace only one, and if it is not available, the flanges which are available in market are flat flanges also, which are faced from both sides and they can connected with each other, okay, so that we can avoid this problem which is related to the assembly of these flanges. Now when these flanges are mount on the input shaft and output shaft, they are fastened together by means of this nut and bolt, okay. Now this fastener which is used, that can be used in numbers equal to 2, 4, 6, okay, even numbers are chosen for the fastening of that flanges, and that is depend upon how much torque you want to transmit. That is nothing but number of bolts are calculated based on torque which you want to transmit. If you see the heavy amount of torque which has to be transmitted by means of coupling, for example high speed couplings which are used for the connecting turbine with the generator, in that case 22 or more than 20 number of bolts are used for that to connect it together. If you have visited to any sugarcane industry, in that case you will find such type of couplings which are used to connect the rolling mill with the roller, as well as this turbine, steam turbine with the generator. Okay, that huge couplings are used, and here this bolts and nuts are used as a standard part. That means separately it is not necessary to design this nut bolt. It can be chosen from the design data book, and standard values for the diameter of that nut and bolt can be selected, and that later on they can be checked for the shear stresses, because here mainly the stress which will occur in the nut and bolt will be shear stress. Okay, basically in case of this bolt, shear stress will occur. Now if you are going to see the proportionate values of various dimensions of this coupling, they are proportionate to the shaft diameter. Okay, if we consider that small d is the shaft diameter, then the capital D as an outer diameter of hub of that coupling. Now here you can see hub is separate and flange is separate. Okay, this hub is part which is up to this part. Okay, this shaded part below this line which I have drawn is called as hub, and the shaded part above this hub is called as flange. Okay, so here you can see this part is considered as a hub of that coupling. Okay, so we are going to select the outer diameter of hub, that is equal to capital D, and that is taken as a 2 times of the inner diameter of that hub. Okay, proportionate values we are going to see. No doubt that when you are going to use this proportionate values for calculating dimensions of this coupling, we have to check it for the allowable stresses, whether these selected values are capable to sustain that stress which will be generated inside the coupling, that we have to check. Then capital D1 is considered as a pitch diameter for the fastener. Okay, pitch diameter for the bolts. This pitch diameter capital D1 is taken as a proportionate to the shaft diameter as a 3D. Okay, D is the shaft diameter here. Now outer diameter of flange is denoted by D2 and is taken as a 4 times of the shaft diameter. No doubt that shaft diameter will be equal to the inner diameter of flange. Getting? These are the various diameters which we have to calculate in case of this flange coupling. Now, the thickness of flange is denoted by T suffix F. This thickness of flange we can calculate, or we can take it in proportion with the diameter of bolt. Okay, it is always taken as a 2 times the diameter of this bolt which we are going to select. Okay, then diameter of bolt can be calculated from the shearing stresses, allowable shearing stresses for this bolt, and number of bolts are also calculated from the total torque which you want to transmit by means of this coupling. Okay, now this recess which has been made and these projections which are has been made in the coupling, that will be taken equal to 1.5 times of the shaft diameter. Okay, diameter of this. Okay, this can be part of design, but here they are not undergoing to any type of stresses, so this value, standard value, we can select this approximation for this projection and recess. Okay, then total width, or we can say it as a length of the hub is taken as a 1.5 times of the shaft diameter. Okay, later on we can check it for the induced stresses. Getting? Now any question related to this slide? Because on this slide we have seen various nomenclatures which are used and their proportionate values also with respect to what? With respect to this shaft diameter. Any question? Let me know if you are having any question related to this flange coupling and its dimension, proportional dimensions. You can write in chat box. Yes. Okay, no question. No problem. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. Okay, the dimensions which we have seen, that can be explained here in this slide. Here outer diameter of flange is taken as a, or denoted by D2, and is taken as a D1 plus D1 minus D, where D is the outer diameter of flange and D1 is what is, okay, you can see here D1 is what? The pitch diameter of bolts. So it can be approximated or proportionate with the pitch diameter minus diameter of hub. Okay. So here it will become 2D1 minus D, that is equal to 4D. Okay, which already we have seen in this diagram. This D2, that is diameter of clange, is equal to 4D. D2, that is diameter, outer diameter of clange, is equal to 4D. A thickness of clange is taken as a 0.5 of shaft diameter or equal to 2 times the diameter of bolt. So I explain you as it is taken thickness of clange as a 2 times of the diameter of bolt, or it is half of the shaft diameter. Whichever may be greater, that we have to select. Okay. Normally, this half of the shaft diameter, that will be greater than the 2 times of the diameter of bolt. The number of bolts which are used in this case are 3, up to 40 millimeter. Okay, this 40 millimeter is the standard pitch diameter of that bolt. Okay, pitch diameter, that is, again, while you are going to see these threads, then this pitch diameter, that is the diameter which is measured at the mid of its crux and valleys, that diameter is considered as a diameter, pitch diameter of the bolt or mean diameter of the bolt. Okay. For 4 bolts, it can be taken equal to 100 millimeter. Okay. Then for 6 bolts, D can be taken it as a 180 millimeter. Now here 3 value, okay, in this slide I have written it as a 3, but it is in multiples of 2. Normally even numbers are selected for the number of bolts. No doubt 3 can be started because it can be placed at 120 degree from each other. That is, at equispace they can be placed. So this 3 is also suitable number of bolts which we can use to fasten the flanges. Okay. Any question? These are the standard values. Okay. 40 millimeter, 100 millimeter, and 180 millimeter. So that are taken from the design data book. You can by heart hit, or if any you are going to calculate actual diameter of the bolt by means of considering shear stresses in that bolt, you can approximate it to the next round of value, and later on you can check it in design data book. Any question? Let me know. No question. Okay. Okay, now you can see here protected type of flange coupling. Now, what is difference between this open flange coupling and protected flange coupling? Only thing is that this cap, which is extended or projected, this cap over the bolt and nut, okay, head of that bolt and nut. This is the projected one. That is the only difference between the open flange coupling and this protected flange coupling. All other things are remaining same. And this protected type of flange couplings are preferable where you are going to connect shafts which are having higher speed, okay, large speed. Why? Because they are used as a protected flange coupling, because at the high speed, if suppose this bolt, because of the vibration and shock, it is a tendency of this fastener that it will get loose, and later on, if suppose any nut will get loose and if it comes out from the bolt or from the threads, then with that speed it will move in straight direction. If any coupling is rotating, okay, and here if suppose that bolt get released from that rotating coupling, then it will go in straight direction with V is equal to R into omega speed. Am I right? which we have seen in theory of machine, R into omega speed it will go. And this omega is calculated as 2 pi n divided by 60. Whereas if the n is more than 1000 rpm, then huge amount of velocity will be there. And how much force it will exert, that will be equal to the centrifugal force. That is, centrifugal force is equal to how much? Mr omega square. M is nothing but the mass of that bolt, R radius at which it is rotating, and omega square, that is nothing but speed square at which it is rotating. So it will be just like a bullet, and if it stucks to any outer part or any human being which is working near to that coupling, it will act as a bullet, getting me? And it may damage to that all equipments which are working or which are near to this coupling. For human being, it will be dangerous to the human being which is working near to the coupling. That's why this protected type coupling is used for the high speed couplings. Okay, this protection is provided. Though if the bolt is going to loose or nut is going to loose from this coupling, it will be restricted to throw or to come out of this flange. Okay, and we can prevent the accidents which may happen because of this high velocity as well as high centrifugal force. Getting me? No doubt that couplings which you might have seen in domestic applications are not of protected type, because large speed machineries we are not going to use. Where you are going to use this large speed machineries, or where you are going to transmit the power through the high speed rotation, at that time we have to use, or we have to go for this protected type flange coupling. Any question? Okay, we'll go to the next slide. Now, design of these flange couplings. First of all, we are going to know the terminology which is used, which you have seen in the previous two slides. Small diameter is the diameter of shaft or inner diameter of hub of that coupling. Capital D is the outer diameter of hub. D1 is the normal diameter, normal outer diameter of the bolt which we are going to use. Capital D1 is the diameter of pitch circle of bolt. Then N is the number of bolts which are used for the coupling. T suffix F is the thickness of flange, and protected thickness of flange again is taken equal to the T suffix F, okay, which I forgot to tell you. And here this protected flange coupling thickness is taken equal to the thickness of this flange, okay, normally. Now T suffix S is the allowable shear stress in shaft. T suffix tau suffix B is the allowable shear stress in the that hub of coupling, and tau suffix K is the allowable shear stress in the key material, okay, or in key. Now tau C is the allowable shear stress in flange material. Tau B is the allowable shear stress for the bolt or bolt material. Now sigma suffix CB is the crushing stresses which are allowed in case of bolt, and sigma suffix CK is the allowable crushing stresses in key material. Okay, allowable shear crushing stress for the key material. So these are the nomenclature which we are going to use, based on which now we are going to calculate the dimensions, or we can check from the that proportionate dimensions that whether that dimensions are capable to sustain the induced stress. Now in case of hub, what will happen? In case of hub, it will undergo to the shear, but where it will get shear? If you are going to see the diagram of this coupling, where is the possibility that this hub will get shear? Can anybody of you tell me? where it is possible that this sharing will occur. If suppose I place only this, okay. If I place only this hub, okay, like in the previous case of mob coupling, the shearing will occur because of the torsional stresses. Am I right? Or torque which you want to transmit will be responsible to create the shear in this hub. Later on, we'll see that this flange part may shear from this hub at the periphery, this periphery. But initially, if you are going to only decide that hub is used and hub has to be transmit, whatever may be the torque which is available on this shaft, that will be transmitted as it is to the hub. And hub should able to transmit it to the flange. Flange will transmit it to the bolts, and this bolt will transmit it to the next flange. Next flange will transmit it to the hub, and this hub will transmit through the key to the output shaft. Can you get the flow through which the torque will get transmitted from input shaft to output shaft? If you are able to imagine this flow, then you will come to know that which type of shearing or bending or compression or tensile type of stresses will get induced in that individual part. Are you getting me? You can write in comment box, chat box, if you are getting it. Okay. So here, what we are going to do is that, okay. First is design of hub. Now hub is designed by considering that it is a hollow shaft, okay, having inner diameter equal to small d and outer diameter as a capital D. So equation which is used to design a hollow shaft, that same equation is used here. That is nothing but torque which is transmitted is equal to pi by 16 into allowable shear stresses in the hub material into d raised to 4. Instead of that d raised to 4, what you have write here, capital D raised to 4 minus small d raised to 4 divided by d. Here you can use k also, that is the ratio of inner diameter to the outer diameter, and equation will become pi by 16 tau c into d capital D raised to 4 into bracket 1 minus k raised to 4. Sorry, capital D raised to 3, because this d will get cancelled. Okay. And you can check that whether by putting the value of capital D and small d here in this equation, you can check that the shear stresses, which we can calculate from this equation for given torque, which you have to transmit, whether that are within the allowable limit or not. Okay. So outer diameter of hub is usually taken as a twice of the inner diameter or diameter of shaft. Therefore, from the above relation, the induced shear stresses in the hub may be checked. The length of hub is taken as a 1.5d, as we have seen in case of proportionate dimensions. That length also can be checked for this value. Here we are not going to calculate length, but this value can be taken as it is for the length of that hub. Now, when we are going to design key, so the key is designed with the usual proportionate or proportions which we have seen in the previous slide, and then check for the shearing and crushing stresses as we have seen in case of design of key. The material of key is usually same as a material of shaft. The length of key is taken equal to the length of hub, definitely, that we have seen in case of mob coupling. Okay. So these dimensions of the key can be calculated, and same equation for the shear and crushing can be used. Got it? Likewise, we can design the key. Now, just we have to design the flange and its dimensions we have to calculate. We'll calculate, or we'll see it to the next lecture. Before that, if you have any question, you are free to ask. You can unmute yourself or you can write in chat box. If not, you can write your roll numbers in chat box, and you can leave this meeting and you can join another meeting, which will be there for the next lecture. Those who are writing their roll number, I request that please leave this meeting so that I will come to know that who is remaining.